When you Google Lee theory, this picture comes up, which makes the theory look more difficult than it actually is. However, if you are familiar with complex numbers, then you have come across an example already. Focusing on these complex numbers with modulus 1, your knee-jerk reaction might be to think about these numbers as e to the I theta. But if you think a little bit more deeply, you are effectively imposing a coordinate system on this circle of complex numbers. So rather than saying, oh, this point, that point, we have a more systematic language to communicate. For example, we can say this point is e to the I times 0.7 pi, and this point is e to the I times 1.3 pi, and everyone knows where on the circle they are. This circle is an example of what's called a Lie group, which will be explained in a second, but in general, it can be much higher dimensional and much harder to visualize. The spirit of Lie theory is that even in these complicated cases, try to impose a coordinate system on it so that it is easier to handle. We won't go through the entirety of Lie's theory in one video, but still, let's spell the theory in slightly more detail, starting with what a Lie group actually is. A Lie group is simultaneously two things. It is a group, but also a manifold. Let's go through what a group is first, because it's an easier concept. Groups are basically a collection of objects that satisfy certain properties that make them look like symmetries. The first property that we expect symmetries to satisfy is closure. We can use the example of symmetries of a regular triangle. If we denote H as the reflectional symmetry along an oblique axis, and G as another reflectional symmetry along the vertical axis, then we define G dot H as a function composition. That is, we first do H, then do G. It turns out, if you want to verify, G composed with H is a rotation. The result isn't important. What's important is that the result is still a symmetry, so it is still in G. But for this axiom to hold, we need to show this for every pair of G and H. You can verify this case by case, but you can also note that symmetries are, by definition, any transformation that preserves the object, in this case, the triangle. So if G and H are symmetries, they preserve the object, then of course, doing H, then G, also preserves the object, and hence, also a symmetry. There are a few other properties that we expect symmetries to follow. This associativity property is relatively straightforward. On both sides, we are describing the transformation that does K first, then H, then G. So they are talking about the same transformations anyway. The next property is basically saying that there is one particular boring symmetry, the not doing anything symmetry, called the identity. This symmetry is so boring that if you have any other symmetry G, G.E or E.G are both G. That is, the identity has done literally nothing here. Finally, we expect all symmetries to have an inverse. So if G is a counterclockwise rotation, then the clockwise rotation H with the same angle would also be a symmetry. H is the inverse because whether you consider G.H or H.G, you end up with the identity symmetry. So you can think of H as undoing the symmetry G, and the undoing itself is also a symmetry. If a collection of objects satisfies these, it forms a group. Symmetries of an object naturally form one. Throughout this video series, we will be dealing with numbers or matrices, and these dots will usually be multiplication and just occasionally addition. Again, only for this video series. If you are given any set of numbers or matrices, like the unit circle of complex numbers in the beginning, it is relatively routine to check if the set satisfies these properties. In this case, you just need to use that moduli multiply, and don't even need to go to Euler's formula to check all these four. Of course, it's not just this circle forming a group. The set of rotation matrices we talked about in the previous video, orthogonal or unitary matrices, all form groups. And if you are not too familiar with groups, I highly recommend you go through the routine check of the group axioms for these sets. All you need is just some properties of the transpose, dagger, and determinant. Anyway, a group is only a part of the puzzle. A Lie group is also a manifold. So, what is a manifold? Well, let's go through an example, the circle of complex numbers. The circle is a manifold in the sense that at every point on it, the neighborhood basically looks like a line, just deformed. Let's zoom into the neighborhood of this point to see what I was saying. In the case of a circle, this is an arc, and it could be smoothly deformed to a straight line. But equally importantly, the line can also be deformed back to the arc smoothly. This two-way deformation is what I mean by looking like a line. Of course, it's not just this point on the circle. Every point has this property that the neighborhood looks like a line. That's why we call the circle a one-dimensional manifold. But there are higher dimensional manifolds as well, and the meaning is similar. It's just that the neighborhood of any point doesn't look like a line anymore, but instead looks like a plane, in this case of a torus. So, not too surprisingly, the surface of a torus is a two-dimensional manifold. A more exotic example is to look at SO3, the rotations in three dimensions. What does SO3 look like? Well, for three-dimensional rotations, we have to first indicate our axis of rotation, and then the angle of rotation around this axis. We can represent this specific rotation as a point on a manifold, which is going to be a solid ball. The corresponding point on the ball will be somewhere along its rotation axis, and where on the axis will depend on your angle of rotation around the axis. For example, this point on the axis, theta units upwards of the center, corresponds to a rotation along this axis by theta. As for the direction, we use the right-hand rule, so this point being upwards of the center would mean a counterclockwise rotation using the right-hand rule. Finally, we limit the angle of rotation to pi, so if your angle of rotation is more than pi, then rotate in the opposite direction. So this is how we can think about SO3 geometrically. But it is quite a weird geometric figure, because these two opposite points actually represent the same rotation. After all, they both represent either clockwise or counterclockwise rotation of 180 degrees. You can actually think of these two points as a portal, so when you rotate more and more in one direction, you cross that pi rotation mark, then you immediately go through the portal and continue your journey upwards. But it's not just one pair of points. Everywhere on the surface of the ball is a portal, just with different axes of rotation. If it sounds weird, it is weird. But still, this is a manifold, more specifically, a three-dimensional manifold, and this can be visualized properly in higher dimensions without portals, but you would have to go to five dimensions to do just that. We will tame this in a different way later on. Anyway, in general, an n-dimensional manifold means that the neighborhoods all look like n-dimensional spaces. There are very technical definitions of these terms, but I don't want to dwell too much on the technicalities. The whole idea that Lie groups are simultaneously groups and manifolds means two things. First, rather than having to think about these SON and SUN purely as a bunch of matrices, we can think about them fairly geometrically, although with higher dimensional rotations, it becomes less visualizable. Second, being at the intersection of these two, we can use tools from group theory and tools from differential geometry, which is the study of manifolds, to tame them. Lee's insight is to think about Lie groups as manifolds first. Another convenient example of a manifold is the surface of the Earth, and a natural thing to do is to impose a coordinate system on it. On Earth, they are latitudes and longitudes, and the reason it's helpful is that the surface of the Earth is curved, but a coordinate system allows you to make a map which is flat, and flat spaces are much easier to deal with than curved ones. Lee's ideas were similar. Lie groups are complicated curved manifolds, and similarly, we would like a coordinate system, a flat space, to deal with it. And that flat space is the Lie algebra. Let's spell this out with just slightly more details. In the case of the Lie group being the circle of complex numbers, the coordinate system consists of the tangent line at the identity, or 1. The way it works is to correspond a tangent vector to a point on the circle in a very natural way. If the length of the vector is theta, then we correspond it to a point on the Lie group a distance of theta away from the identity. This vector could actually be thought of as I theta. That's because a complex number is not just a point on a plane, it can also be thought of as a vector emanating from the origin to that point. So, an upward vector would correspond to a purely imaginary number. So this upward tangent vector can be thought of as I theta. But we said, as a coordinate system, the tangent vector corresponds to a point distance theta away from the identity, and you know what is this point? This is exactly e to the I theta, and this is also very similar to how more general Lie groups and algebras work. First, we have a Lie group, and we want to find the identity of the group. Once we have done that, consider the tangent space at the identity. This flat space is the corresponding Lie algebra for the Lie group. The way Lie algebra works as a coordinate system is for a tangent vector on the tangent space to sort of wrap around the Lie group, and then take the endpoint. This wrapping around action to correspond a tangent vector to a point on the manifold is called the exponential map. In this specific case, the vector I theta is wrapped around to give e to the I theta on the Lie group. So it is literally an exponential map. But this notion of exponential map carries over to general manifolds, not just Lie groups. In other words, even for a general manifold, the idea of mapping a tangent vector on the tangent space to a point on a manifold is still called the exponential map. And ideally, we would want to just work with this flat space because it's easier to deal with than curved objects. This exponential map, or actually the inverse or logarithmic map, will reduce a point on the manifold back to a tangent vector on a flat space. So that's the first step in understanding Lie groups. Thinking about it as manifolds, we want to reduce the Lie group to its Lie algebra, the tangent space at identity, via logarithm. But what insight can we have if we think of Lie groups as groups as well? Ultimately, what the group axioms are telling us is what the group elements in these dots should satisfy. So we care about how multiplication works in such a group. As an illustration, we have a Lie group with the identity represented as a red dot, and the corresponding Lie algebra, which again, is just a tangent space at the identity. The red dot in the middle corresponds to the identity on the Lie group. Let's consider a pair of elements gh and their product g dot h. We can replicate all these on the Lie algebra with the logarithm map that reduces all these points down to the tangent vectors on a flat space. Now, if we just have these tangent vectors corresponding to g and h, could we still figure out the tangent vector corresponding to g dot h without referring back to the Lie group? A naive guess might be what you expect for normal numbers, that the logarithm of the product is just adding up the logs. But these g's and h's are matrices, which do not multiply the same way as numbers do. However, there is actually a formula. If we denote log g to be x, log h to be y, and log g dot h to be z, then z can be obtained as an infinite series. It looks intimidating, but it can be broken down to two simple operations. First, addition or subtraction. This is exactly the addition or subtraction of those tangent vectors. Second, these square brackets. These are called Lie brackets. And for now, you can think about them as a simple but specific operation that turns two tangent vectors into another tangent vector. So, if we also know the Lie bracket, then we know the tangent vector that corresponds to g dot h. This formula, called the Baker-Campbell-Hausdorff formula, BCH for short, allows us to replicate the group multiplication entirely on the Lie algebra. So instead of working with the curved space, as far as group multiplication is concerned, we can work purely on the Lie algebra, a flat space. Now, on the Lie group, the group axioms tells us what we should expect from the multiplication, and on the Lie algebra, the Lie bracket would also correspondingly satisfy some properties. For now, the details of these properties are not important, but just know that these properties of the Lie bracket generally come from the properties of multiplication in the Lie group. Recognizing these properties is yet another step in completely abandoning the Lie group and only focusing on the Lie algebra instead. So, while the manifold part of Lie groups wants us to reduce it back to the Lie algebra, the group part actually allows us to do so by considering a simple operation called the Lie bracket. Nowadays, most textbooks would define Lie algebra as a vector space with a Lie bracket satisfying all these properties, but it should be worth noting that these Lie groups are the important motivation for these properties. And this leads us to this picture that is supposed to represent Lie theory. What is this? Here is a short answer. If you heard of the monster group, the idea is similar. If not, for monster groups, basically we want to think about finite groups, finite sets G, so that we can define multiplication that satisfies these axioms. These finite groups can be broken down into different building blocks, which are called simple groups. These are basically the atoms of finite groups, and mathematicians would like to classify these building blocks. There are many different mechanisms to produce infinitely many simple groups. The building blocks produced in a similar way are grouped together in one of these infinite families. But there are quite a lot of possibilities left, called sporadic groups. There are 26 or 27 of them, depending on whether you want to count one of them in those infinite families. This building block, by the way, is called Tits group, named after the French mathematician Jacques Tits, who actually died just 1.5 years ago. That's a bit of a tangent, because the star of these sporadic groups is the monster group, by far the largest and the most complicated out of these 26-27 sporadic groups. This classification is similar to what was done to Lie algebras a century ago. Similar to how groups are defined, the Lie algebra also has a Lie bracket that satisfies certain properties. And only using these properties, we want to classify the building blocks of Lie algebras. Similar to the case for groups, there are infinite families of these simple Lie algebras. But unlike groups, there are way fewer of these. There are exactly 4, labeled AN, BN, CN, and DN respectively. In addition to these infinite families, there are exactly 5 that are left out, called exceptional Lie algebras, and are labeled E6, E7, E8, F4, and G2 respectively. E8 is the most complicated out of those 5, so it is sort of the equivalent of the monster group in Lie algebras. This particular picture is a pictorial description of E8. So even though we wanted to study Lie groups, we turned to studying Lie algebras instead, because all the information is retained and they are simpler to study. However, there are a few questions unanswered, like why is this wrapping around a general manifold called the exponential map? Or what exactly are these Lie brackets? These will be answered in the upcoming videos in the video series, including a whole video of limitations of the exponential map, because everything in this video comes with a few caveats. Those caveats do not undermine the overall picture, but they are still important if you want to go further to explore the meaning of quantum spin. As usual, please consider giving on Patreon, subscribe, and get notified when a new video in the series goes up. And like the video, and I will see you next time.